We have a question that we have to answer. Exodus chapter 30. We'll start there. Father, pray you bless your word this morning. We thank you for the privilege of being here. Pray that you might fill us with the Holy Spirit and enable us to be able to teach and to preach. Thank you, Lord, for the folks that are already gathered here. And pray that you'll meet with us in the service. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, Exodus chapter 30. Now, this is not have anything at all to do with the book of Revelation, but the question was asked the other day. It's a good question, and I had to go do my due diligence because I did not know the correct answer to that. And so let's go back over it. Look, if you will, please. Exodus chapter 30. The question is about verse number 16, or actually 15. The rich shall not give more, the poor shall not give less than a half shekel when they give an offering unto the Lord to make an atonement for your souls. Notice your souls, not their souls, your souls. And thou shalt take an atonement money of the children of Israel, and shall appoint it to the service of the tabernacle of the congregation, that it may be memorial unto the children of Israel before the Lord to make an atonement for your souls. All right, now what they usually do with this, and the multitude of places that you look for it, what they try to do is take away from it and make it like, well, that's a reference to the Lord coming in the future, and it's showing the great price that he paid and that kind of a thing. That has nothing to do with it. What it has to do with, notice first of all, verse number 12, same passage. When thou takest the sum of the children of Israel after their number, so it has to do with a count, has to do with them counting something unto the Lord. Notice the ransom for his soul unto the Lord when thou numberest them, that there be no plague among them when thou numberest them. So the ransom is offered that he's fixing to talk about here so that when they number it, that there's not a plague. Look, if you will, leave your finger there and come to 2 Samuel chapter 24. 2 Samuel chapter 24. Now, in 2 Samuel chapter number 24, every time the children of Israel get ready to number anything, of course, David does it here, when they get ready to number, they didn't offer the ransom, so a plague follows. So the reason for giving the ransom is to prevent the plague. David refused to take up the ransom for it, and so as a result of that thing, look in verse 9, Joab gave the sum and number of the people unto the king, and there was in Israel 800,000 valiant men who drew the sword. So it's just a count of the men, and the men of Judah were 500,000 men. Come down to verse number 14. David said unto Gad, I am in a great strait. Let us fall now into the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great, and let me not fall into the hand of man. So the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning unto the time appointed, and there died the people of Dan, even to Beersheba, 70,000 men. Why did they get this 70,000 men? Because they didn't pay the ransom that was required. Look over in verse 24. The Bible says this, and of course David builds the threshing floor and so on and so forth, goes over there and says, I'll not offer anything that doesn't cost me something. And then he says, verse 24, and the king said unto Araunah, nay, but I will surely buy it of thee of the price, neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which thou cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor, watch it, and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. All right, now come back over, if you will, please. Notice the shekels show up again in Exodus chapter number 30. Now what this thing has to do with is a shekel is worth between 30 and 60 cents. And nobody is more valuable than anybody else when it comes to death. So it doesn't matter if you're a captain or a general. It doesn't matter if you're a king or anybody else. Everybody offers the same price. That's what he's talking about in the passage. In the passage, what he's saying is this. He's saying that when it comes time for you to go out to war, Exodus 12, let me show you that. Exodus chapter number 12. These individuals are getting ready to go out to war, and this has only to do with men. And it has to do with those that are over 20 years of age. And what you're doing is you're offering an atonement in a sense of so that if you die on the battlefield and you die unclean or whatever, that it covers it for that. It has nothing to do with an atonement as far as you would know it for us in this day and time. But it means that if you go out to battle and you lose your life in battle, paying that atonement is the thing that takes care of it. Exodus chapter number 12. And verse number 7. The children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 on foot, that were men beside the children. So when the Lord gets ready to count, he always counts the sum according to the males that are there. This is not to be offensive to you, but he counts males at 20 years of age and up, and he counts. He doesn't count the females and the children. And so when he's doing that, come back to Exodus chapter number 30. These guys are given a ransom for their soul, verse 13. This they shall give everyone that passeth among them that are numbered. So they're numbering out their armies here and getting ready to divide them up. Half a shekel after the shekel of the sanctuary, a shekel and 20 gerahs, half shekel shall be offering unto the Lord. Everyone that passeth among them that are numbered, here's the key, from 20 years old and above shall give an offering to the Lord. So it obviously has to do with individuals that are getting ready to go out to war. And the ones that are coming by there, they're given that atonement for the army of Israel. Verse 15, the rich shall not give more, the poor shall not give less than a half a shekel. It was something that everybody could pay. When they shall give an offering to the Lord to make an atonement for your souls, so that when you go out there in the battlefield, the ransom is taken up to not only prevent the plague from coming on you, but if you die on the battlefield, your soul is atoned for in the sense of you not having the opportunity to offer the animal. Now, that's about as good as I can do with it. Notice it goes, verse number 16, that the money goes for the support of the ministry there. They shall appoint it for the service of the tabernacle of the congregation. Now, that matches in 2 Corinthians chapter number 9, so we'll turn there real quick. So, Miss Sandy, the best that I can do with this thing is this. It does have to do with an atonement to keep an individual when they go out to war from dying in their sin, so to speak, as you would say. And it has to do only with those people that are going out to war. Secondly, it is a way for them to get an idea by counting the shekels how many people they have that are able to go out to war. But here's the strange thing about it. Everywhere that they tried to use numbers, if the Lord's the one keeping the numbers, everywhere they started trying to number something, they started getting puffed up and proud about it, and the Lord always got they always allowed them to get the tar knocked out of them. God, you say, well, in the book of Numbers, you know, God said, no, that's God keeping numbers. You start keeping numbers, as human nature is, as you start counting how much money you got in the bank account, you depend on your bank account for your security. You start counting your numbers when it comes to human beings. You start counting how many missiles you got, and how many tanks you got, and how many airplanes you got, and how many this and that and the other. You say, well, it's just a matter of keeping up. But if you're not careful, what will happen is you begin to rely on that instead of relying on God. And so when David goes over there and he stands up there to number the children of Israel, even Joab comes to him. And Joab says, King, it'd be a good idea not to do that because God doesn't like you knowing what the numbers are. That's God's business. Let him keep the numbers. Now, pride gets in the way every time you get around numbers. People say, well, it's just a good way to mark your progress. Well, not necessarily so. When it comes to marking your progress, your growth spiritually has nothing to do with numbers. How many years you've served the Lord has nothing to do with how spiritual you are. Do you understand? Well, I've been a Christian for 15 years. Okay, what does that mean? Somebody might be a Christian for 2 years and be a better Christian than you are at 15 years. Depends on where you make the mark at. Well, you know, back in the old days of the Southern Baptists, what they did is they keep up with how many decisions they made and how many they baptized and how many additions to the church and how much money given to the cooperative program and how much money given to Lottie Moon and how much money given to Annie Armstrong. How many people did they just support this and how many did they support that? You got to be real careful about that because that becomes a place of boasting for you. How many people do you run in attendance? How many people have you seen led to the Lord? How many people have you baptized? How many people have you done this? How many people have you done that? There's no way that eventually that thing doesn't turn around and make you feel sort of like, you know, you did something when it was God that did the thing in the first place. So you want to be real careful about that kind of thing. People want to count up with how much stuff they got and how many things and that kind of a deal. Everywhere in the Bible, those numbers show up where the Lord's not in it. The Lord allows them to get the tar knocked out of them. The Lord does a lot with a little. Amen. If you measure success by numbers, then God must have been, and Jesus Christ must have been the most unsuccessful preacher that there ever was. He had 12 following him. One of them was a devil. When he died, there was only around 500 people that ever saw him after he died. He didn't have much of a following, if you measure it. All right, John the Baptist, how many did he have following him? You don't know. Bible doesn't say. How many followed Elijah? You don't know. Bible doesn't say. How many followed Elijah? I don't know. The Bible doesn't say. How many followed Moses? Well, you start seeing the division of the tribes there, but then you make sure that you understand that that's the Lord making the count. That's where numbers comes in. Numbers are important in the Bible as long as it's God keeping up with it. And when you start keeping up with it and I start keeping up with it, then you start, you know, well, how many did you run in Sunday school? Like, that means you're growing. I heard one preacher get up one time and he said, well, you know, God likes numbers. That's why he wrote the book of Numbers. God likes numbers when he keeps the numbers, but you can't use that as justification for yourself to keep numbers. Now, if you want to keep numbers, that's fine, but that's why we don't have a board up here and says how many in attendance and how many gave and how many came and how many did and how many that and how many this. You say, well, that's because we don't have anybody. Okay, well, you say whatever you want to say, but but the bottom line is this, ladies and gentlemen, when you start keeping that, I'm not talking about accountability now. I'm talking about I've seen people get proud of everything. Look how much we've done. Look how much we've spent. Look how much we've paid off. Look how much we gave. Look how many missionaries we support. I've been in churches. You've got a nice missionary board back here in the back. I've been in churches where their missionaries would fill a whole wall like this right here and be missionaries. Now, I'm for missions. But what you may not know about that is that you're looking across there and there may be 60 or 70 missionaries up there all supported at $5 a month. You don't know. There's one church that I know of that supports that many people, and they support them substantially, I mean with a huge dollar amount, and that's the church in Pensacola. But the rest of them, it becomes, you know, kind of like, well, I'm supporting this many missionaries, so we must be spiritual. Not necessarily. A lot of times Christians camouflage things behind something else. One of the most wicked people I've ever known in my life was the Sunday school superintendent. And he was one of the most wicked men I've ever known in my entire life. And he was always boasting how many people he could get into church and how many people he could get to come to certain events and how many people he could gather together at social events and how many people he could get this and how many people he could get that and supposedly how many people he led to Jesus Christ and all that kind of stuff. And he was wicked as a devil. It just took about 20 years to manifest itself. You want to be careful about that. That's why I'm trying to just caution you. That's not a mark of spirituality. Numbers has nothing to do with spirituality. Amen. God's not impressed with seniority at all. Amen. If anything, if you're a senior Christian, you should be ahead of those of us that are not as senior as you are. Amen. You should be more gracious and more merciful and more long-suffering. Amen. You should be more kind. Amen. You should be more generous and more caring. In other words, you should be more like Jesus. And cut the rest off us a little slack. I've only been at it about 50 years or so. I've still got a ways to go, But the thing that you starts happening is you start paying attention. That's why we don't do thermometers here. I'm being serious. You say, why? I can't erase it out of my mind. I can't get it away from. I've seen the board lit up there and have the map of the world up there and Lottie Moon stuff at Christmas time and Annie Armstrong and all that stuff and have the lights up there and people, you know, standing up and I'll turn on a light and what Sunday school class will turn on a light, another Sunday, turn on a light, and then have some of the board out and then some, you know, fellow that's got, you know, the dollar bills hanging out of his ears, you know, he stands up, well, how many lights you got left up there, preacher? You know how many, you've been counting them. Right. I'll never forget it. Sat right back here just about where Brother Greg is. Big church back then. Big church, big balcony and all that kind of stuff. Stand up, you know, throw his chest out, and, you know, and I'm a kid, but I remembered it. Scarred me, I guess. I'll never forget it. He said, how many lights you got up there? And he turned around and he counted and came up to however much money. He says, well, just turn them all on. I'll take care of it. Well, that's what that stuff leads to. You want to be careful about that. That'll get you in some serious trouble. Now, let me show you how to get you in trouble. How many times you get to sing last month? Amen. How many times you get to preach when the preacher was out of town? Don't tell me keeping numbers don't get you in trouble. Amen. That's your position of determining whether or not you are or you aren't. That's what you keep up with. Years of experience. Then years of experience don't mean anything at all if you don't use it the right way. Amen. Again, I'm not talking about accountability. We got a good bean counter here. He's been faithful for 20 years, and you, the CPA firm that comes in and does our audit every year says if he ever doesn't want to do anything for you anymore, I'll hire him. He doesn't even have a degree in finance, but he said he's better than people that have a degree in finance. I mean, he's one of them. Every nickel, every dime, every penny. You try to say, well, you know, Brad, we came up short. Well, here, just take the penny. No, it's here somewhere. It's here somewhere. Then we'll count all that again. Yeah, it's got to be here somewhere. I must have missed it. But when you got somebody like that, you don't ever have to worry about somebody getting you in the back. Every dime accounted for. That's what he's talking about. That's the right thing to do. But the counterbalance to that is don't get hung up on numbers. How many are running? How many not? I don't know. When there's not enough room for people to seat, I guess it's to sit. It's time to move.
Yeah, right.
Or kick a wall out or something.
Right.
Yeah. How many does it hold? I don't know. We'll stuff it till the fire marshal says we can't. Put out chairs. You can sit on the platform for all I care if you want to get that close. Sit up here. But once that's filled up, it's like, okay, the fire marshal says you got too many people in here. Well, we're not going to violate it in the name of Jesus.
Right.
And what are you going to do? Turn people away? Listen, I've heard about a service here not long ago where they got some ladies got involved in their husbands got involved in a car accident, real bad one, killed them both. And they went out in the neighborhoods where their husbands were going and trying to get people to come and said, our husbands died because they wanted you to come to church and this and that and the other. And a bunch of people came and they had twice as many people standing in the parking lot. No fire rule against that. Twice as many people standing in a parking lot. They took these big big screen thing or another, not TV things, but the outdoor thing. I can't think of what I'm thinking. In my mind, it's like a movie screen, but it won't come to my mind. And they set those things out there. And they had services like that for months. Just people stand outside and watch it on. You say, well, preacher, nobody's going to do that. Well, they did. So how many was it? He didn't say. Just said we had too many in the church, so they filled up the parking lot. So they had people parking in other places, and they were bussing them in so they could stand in the parking lot and watch the service.
Amen.
That must have been something, man.
Right.
You ever seen them old days of Billy Graham things where you have 100,000 people at a place and fill up a coliseum, a football stadium? My goodness, man. All right, now here's this thing right here. It's just so you get this. To answer Sandy's question, then we'll get onto the book of Revelation. The answer Sandy's question, Miss Sandy, that thing is an atonement for warriors that are going out to battle. And they pay that in lieu of not being where they can offer the sacrifice. They go ahead and pay that. So it has a twofold purpose. One, it's that atonement if they die in battle because they're going to battle now. And they realize that they may not win every battle and some people are going to die in battle. So that's the reason. And the second reason is to have them be able to number what's out there so that when the people return, they got an idea by looking at it where it goes. One fellow said this. He said they then took that silver and melted it down and used it for the latchets and all that so that it would be a constant reminder to people. I don't know about that, but silver in the Bible has to do with redemption. And that thing has to do with an atonement so that they were able to pay that. And that's just for the warriors. That's not for anybody else. All right, here's your rule in 2 Corinthians 9. Just so that you know, and then we'll get on to the book of Revelation. 2 Corinthians chapter number 9. You're not under the law. You don't have to tithe. Did you hear me? I know you don't believe a Baptist preacher tell you that, but you don't. You're not under the law. But the tithe is there before the law. And it's there under the law, and it's there after the law. But your rule is this, verse 6. But this I say, 2 Corinthians 9, 6, he which soweth, now see, it's, what I'm trying to contrast is it's required of them in the Old Testament. It's not required of you. The Bible says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according to the purpose in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, like they did back then. They had to give it then. But now you don't, for God loveth a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that having always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Let me clarify this as you turn to the book of Revelation. That doesn't mean that if you give bountifully, that you're going to get monetarily bountifully back. That reward may be at the judgment seat of Christ. That reward may be in the grace that God gives to you that you don't know about until you get up there. It's not always monetary like the charismatic teaches or like it was in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, if you gave bountifully of your fruits and vegetables and things like that, the Lord blessed your crops. Therein lies the bless you, sister, twice. There's in the Old Testament, that's where you said, where the Lord said, the first fruits of the go unto the Lord. Well, that was for the provision. That's the first fruits coming out of the fruit, I mean out of the field. And so the Lord says, if you do that, I'll open the windows of heaven. He's not talking about this is how it's taught. You throw it up with a spoon, God throws it back with a shovel. Like you're throwing pennies up there and God's throwing back dollar bills at you. The context of that passage has to do with the farming. You bring the stuff to the Lord and the Lord will bless your crops.
Amen.
Doesn't have anything to do with you.
Amen.
In this day and age, God has ways of blessing you. Suppose the more you give, the more you suffer.
Yeah.
Right.
Able to make all grace abound, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, suppose the more you give, God says, okay, good, I appreciate that. Now I'm going to give you something that you can't even imagine. I'll give you an eternal reward for that. Here's some cancer for you, and here's some financial difficulty for you, and here's some sickness for you, and here's some torn up family for you, and here's this and here's that. And you say, well, now why would God do that? To let you know He's blessing you.
Amen.
God has a different way of blessing Christians in this age.
Amen.
You see, I wish they'd just tell you that straight up. They won't tell you that. What they want to tell you is that, you know why you play the lottery? You know why you play the lottery? You want something for nothing. And you're hoping. You ever get those emails? Your email has been selected and you have won this, so on and so forth. You know, just respond back to us within the next 24 hours. You're a partaker of the $1 million cash reward. Yeah, I'm going to be clicking on that right away. But you know what covetous will do? It'll say, yeah, I want that. You know why you play the lottery? You're gambling. You're saying, well, I'd like to invest a little and get a lot. God don't work that way. Now, you may give your last dollar bill and die impoverished. There's no guarantee. Luke 6, pressed down, shaken together twice over, baked in the oven, handed back to you, raw dough, now fresh bread, all that. That's not for you. You may give and give and give and give your whole heart, give your body, give your soul, give your mind. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep, right? Well, if I'm supposed to be a shepherd, then I give my life. That means little pieces of my life go out every time I minister. That's how it's supposed to be. Isn't that what Jesus Christ did? I'm not comparing myself to Him. Isn't that what Paul did? Amen. Isn't that what the apostles did? That's the ministry.
Amen.
That's a Christian life. Cut the veins and bleed out for somebody else.
Amen.
It's not about you.
Right.
Blessing somebody else. Let God use you. What does He want to do? Burn you up.
Amen.
So you just cease to exist. You just don't exist anymore. Enoch walked with God. It was not. What happened to him? So much like God, people couldn't even see Enoch anymore, just saw God. So what you have to understand in the New Testament, when it comes to giving, get out of your mind that if I give to God, then God's going to bless me monetarily. Number two, don't ever think that because you give to God, or don't give to God, that means God's going to get His tithe out of your water heater. I've heard that taught.
Yeah, that's right.
I've heard, bless God, if you don't give, God will get His money out of you. Oh, why would God want to do that? That makes it forcible. Doesn't He say in there, not grudgingly or of necessity?
That's right.
You think He's lying when He says that?
No.
He's telling you the truth.
Amen.
He said, if you don't want to give it, or you feel like you've got to give it, or somebody's holding a gun to your head, or you've given it but you don't want to give it, He said, keep it. And there's nothing in there that says, and if you do that, I'll blow up your water heater. I'll flatten your tires. I'll make your kids sick.
Right.
That's Him holding you. That's extortion.
That's right.
Now you're, that ain't God. God's given you a chance to get in on what He's doing. If you don't want to do it, don't do it. That's why no pressure on giving here. I don't believe in it. I don't think it's right. God finances what He needs to finance and gets done what He needs to done. We wait until we got it, and we got it, we do it. They say to do it, and if they don't say to do it, I say, okay, well, they say we don't do it. Okay, what are you going to do about that? Put the church up their ears in debt? No, I listen to what they tell me.
Right.
Okay, well, all right, we'll wait. Multitude of counselors, there's wisdom.
Yeah.
I can be deceived by ambition.
Yeah.
Yeah, me, I can be deceived by ambition. I can be deceived by envy. Or jealousy or covetousness. Well, how come that guy's got a building over there and he's running 1,000? I know what we need to do. We need to build a place that has 1,000, then they'll come. Let's get the 1,000 and then build it to meet the need instead of building it and hoping God will fill it.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. That's the way. That's there's a fine line between faith and stupidity.
Yeah.
That ain't faith. That's stupidity.
Yeah.
That's good. Hey, you should amen me there. I'm not going to put a bit in a bridle. I'm not spiritual enough to handle it. If I can't imagine, there's a fellow I know, it's a friend of mine, and he's got this gigantic, it's something like $40,000 or $50,000 a month that he has to have to get all his people paid for, get the building paid for, and get all that. I'd have a heart attack. I couldn't stand it, number one. Number two, I ain't spiritual enough. I'd be browbeating the tar out of you saying, you better give some money, man, or your preacher's going to die. I saw a 900-foot Jesus standing at my bed. He said, he's going to take me home if you don't give some. I mean, I'd be worried about paying for it. I'm being honest with you. I'm not that spiritual. You know, I'd like to think I am. Well, you know, if you build it, they'll come. This ain't Kevin Costner in a baseball field. I'm not like that. I figure it like this. One of my fellows told me one day, he said, well, preacher, we are getting kind of crowded, but just give it time. And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you're going to say something sooner or later, and it's going to thin the crowd out. He said, history, preacher, history. You know, one thing about men know about history, they never learn from history. I said, okay, well, maybe you're right. Well, that's probably true. It's funny. Maybe it hurts your feelings a little bit, but it's true. Listen, that's God's problem. I don't care if people sit on the floor.
Amen.
I'm not going to fix it where everybody can be plush and comfortable and taken care of and put people in bondage to do it. Now, let me give you real liberty, okay? The Lord said, if you got it to give, if you want to give it, give it. And if you don't, keep it. No problem. Let's move on.
Amen.
There's no guilt involved in it. Not of necessity, not grudgingly. That doesn't mean that if I don't... A fellow said this, you know, I blew up his tires there on the side of the road, and we're over there working, getting tires changed out and all that kind of stuff. The fellow says to him, he said, well, I guess that's what happens when you don't tithe. Really? You think God has to, he's got to get his 10% out of your car tires? You think everything that happens to you is God getting what? Listen, buddy, listen. You can't pay him back.
That's right.
He'd take everything you got and then some. He owns it all anyway.
That's right.
You think God's up there looking at you? You stinking chintzy little thing, you. You think God's looking at you like this and saying, I'm going to get mine out of you, buddy. What do you got to give him? He owns everything.
Right.
These people, you could put all the billionaires together in one room. They can't even hold a thimble full of what God's got.
That's right.
You think God's going to look down at common people like me and you working hard for a living and trying to make a way and stuff like that and sit there and squabble with you over whether or not you're tithing right now? Now, Brad ain't liking this too much because he's thinking, well, there goes the offering. When he gave you a free gift, was it free or not?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Why are you trying to earn your way back in or pay him back? He don't want you feeling guilty about what he did for you. After all he did for you, shouldn't you be doing something for... I guess I should. Isn't that the most frustrating thing in the world? You ever had that card played on you?
Yep.
How about growing up in your family? Well, I walked 40 miles in the snow, and I did this, and I did... I carried you in my tummy, and I... Really? God, you've got a bad conception of God. God's given you a chance to get in on something.
Amen.
But you don't get to get in on it if you do it for any other reason than I want to do it.
Amen.
I love to do it.
Amen.
Psh, I got it. Here, Lord, do something with it. I can't do nothing with it. Do something with it. God's checking you out. That's all. You don't want to give it? God doesn't say, Gabriel, mark that and down. We got it. See, what can I do? You know, that microwave's about on the blink. Shouldn't be microwaving food anyway. I tell you what, let's do Christmas Eve. Let's blow up their microwave. She'll be in a fix then because everybody's coming tomorrow and she won't have no way to get everything ready. Yeah, that's a good idea. So then you wake up the next morning and oh my God, it's the microwave. What are we going to do? Should have been tithing. Reap what you sow, honey. Oh, I don't believe that.
Amen.
Now, somebody gets a hold of this, is going to shoot a hole in their theology, and they're going to get out and say, oh, well, Brother Peacock's teaching contrary. No, I'm not. Not grudgingly and not of necessity.
Amen.
That's your rule. In the Old Testament, it was a necessity. It's not an atonement for your soul. He's already made the atonement. Let me just show you that real quick, if I can, please. I think that's over in Matthew. It'll be Matthew chapter 20. Now, he's already made an atonement. You can't pay your way in or out. Certain religions, they teach that you can pay somebody out of hell. That's what they do. That you can be a ransom for them. Well, you got a problem there. You can't ransom anybody out of hell. What a demented thing. What a way to get money out of people. If you thought your loved one was burning in hell right now and they said to you and you believed it, that if you gave all the money that you possibly had and they gave you a number to reach, let's say, I don't know, $10,000, you give us $10,000 and we'll guarantee you that person is no longer in hell, well, wouldn't you pay it? No wonder they got a gold dome on their monastery in Rome. No wonder why they have their own army and their own nation. Because you say, why? People think, well, shoot, man, what are they going to say if I show up there and I'm in heaven and they're down there in hell? And they say, well, why didn't you pay me out? I thought you said they believed like you believe. They still teach limbo and they still teach purgatory. You say, why? It's how they built people out of money. Matthew chapter number 20. That's it, yeah. Verse 27. Whosoever will be chief among you, let him be a servant. Let him be your servant. That's a mouthful. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. So what happens is the Lord's already paid your ransom. You can't pay off that debt. There's no way you can pay off that debt. Let me give you one more thing here, and I'll show you this. I wasn't going to stay on this, but it's just a good thing to do. I'm looking for that woe unto you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites thing here. Make long prayer. It's there in Matthew. It's on the right-hand page, right-hand column. If somebody sees it before I do, speak out. 23, I believe it is. Yeah, 23. That's what I'm looking for. Now, there's no difference in a Roman Catholic teaching what I'm about to show you and a Baptist teaching it. You want to see God's vision for this taken care of, then give your money and let's see God's vision realized. How we know it's God's vision? If it's God's vision, don't you think you already got it piled up and ready to do something with it? That's a safer way, isn't it? Be quiet there. The safer way, if God's got ready to do something, God provides where He guides, He provides, right?
Amen.
Well, let's just make sure that we stay the course, and then all of a sudden it's like, okay. Preacher, what should you do about the parking lot? I don't know. You know what my fellow said? Well, let's wait until we got it. Let's get some bids. Let's see how much it costs. We finally got the amount of money that we needed to get it done. Okay, good. What else we got to spend it on? Nothing. All right, good. Let's spend it. Now we got a nice parking lot back there. But that's we're in this building. How many years we've been in this building now? 8 years, 10 years, something like that. That back there has been undeveloped since we moved in here. Since we've been here. 20 years nearly. Well, how come you didn't do it? We couldn't afford it. Verse 14. I'm not gonna bilk that out of you folks. Verse 23, our chapter 23, verse 14, verse 13. Woe unto you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites! You shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in. Woe unto you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites! For you devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. What do you mean devour widows' houses? You take away their houses because you're teaching them that you better give to get in. The church was never designed to make you impoverished just so the church can flourish. That's a misconception. You can't pay your bills? Pay your bills. The fellow says, well, if you can't pay your bills, the reason you can't pay your bills is you're not tithing. Now, I'm not so sure about that. Maybe you're in over your head. Maybe you got problems. Maybe you got medical bills. Maybe you got things that came your way you didn't expect to come your way. Well, I just know what I would do. Well, I'm glad you would. Maybe God's been merciful and not put one of those situations on you where the tank ran dry. Your spirituality is not determined by a dollar amount on a thing. How about this? I know people that can't give a dime, but they can give their time. That don't count? Well, that's different. Well, why is that different? I'll tell you this. I know people that it's easier for them to give dollars than it is to give of themselves. So be careful how you put an issue on there. If you got it, good. Praise the Lord. Give it. Give it with a grudgingly. If you don't, keep it. So, well, what happens to the offering? That's God's problem. It's not my problem. I'll be jumped if I'm going to try to pull the wool over your eyes just to keep something going. Maybe God's done with it. If He quits financing it, I guess He's done with it. Well, who am I to say otherwise? Well, see, you want the will of God, right? But you kind of get fixated on, you know, I've decided what the will of God is. Now you're asking God to bless it. Whoa, hold on a minute. I've seen people go into business and go, well, I just know this is God's will, I just know this is God's will, I just know this is God's will. And they get into business and then God bless it, and then God don't bless it. And they're like, well, if it's God's will, how come He ain't blessing it? How come it is if you want God's will that you don't say this, okay, maybe the Lord's ready to shut it down. Maybe He's done. Maybe He wants to move on. That's just as much the will of God as it is for it to flourish. It's just easier to always be this ambitious, we're going to see it grow and go and grow. And maybe God's going to say, okay, I'm done. Get out of here. We're finished. I'm going to have you go into captivity. You're done with Israel. I'm going to take you away. And it's my perfect will for you to be in captivity. Don't fight them when they come to get you. That can't be God's will. 400 of them said, that's not God's will. One of them said, oh yeah, remember? When they get over there, we go out to battle. He says, I'm going out to battle. And Micaiah comes up there and he says, the Lord said, don't do it. After he got sarcastic with him. He never prophesies anything good concerning me. And he said, okay, well, if today they happen to bring you back home, then I'm a liar and all that kind of stuff. They smack him and put him in jail. And that day Ahab did. Just because the masses say that's how we ought to do it, don't mean that's how you ought to do it.
Amen.
Could be God's will to say, okay, I'm done. Have a seat. We're through with you. Next.
Amen.
Time for you to be replaced. All right, let's just stop there. We'll take an early break here today instead of getting over into the book of Revelation. And I'll let you out 5 minutes early, and that means you'll get out 5 minutes early in the regular morning service.